Hello everyone, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we are going to see the news analysis of 5th December 2018. So these are the 7 topics which we are going to see for the prelims. The first one we are going to see is the Disabilities Act of 2016. The second one we are going to see is that India-US will sort out the sanction waiver. Third one is about the India-Bhutan relations and the newly proposed Hydel Power Project. Fourth one is that the Swadesh Darshan Scheme. Fifth one is that India Water Impact Summit of 2018. Sixth one is about the OPEC. And the last one is that India gets WTO nod to establish the dispute panel regarding the US tariffs on steel and aluminium imports. The first article we are going to see is that a study conducted by Disability Rights India Foundation on the Disabilities Act of 2016. And this article has been taken from the Hindu. The Indian government in 2016, in order to have an inclusive development, and in accordance with the constitutional principles of equality, justice, it has framed the Disabilities Bill and passed an act regarding the disability in 2016. So now we shall see the features of this act. The main feature of this new act is that it has added the disabilities from 7 to 21. In that, they have added the mental illness and intellectual disability. So these are the two main features that has been added to this bill of 2016. And other things are the disability has been defined for the first time based on evolving and dynamic concept. The reservation in government jobs has been also widened from 3% to 4% for the disabled persons who are classified under this Disabilities Act. Upon these features, the Indian government has widened the Article 21A, which says about the right to free education for those children who are disabled between the age group of 6 to 18 years. Whereas for the normal people, the right to free education follows only for the 6 to 14 years of age. Apart from this, this Disabilities Act is in line with the United Nations Convention on Rights of Persons with Disability, to which India is a signatory. To add a feather on its cap, the Act has also widened the creation of national and state fund through which it will provide financial support to the persons with the disabilities. Also, in order to have a speedy and timely justice for these disabled persons, special courts will be established in each district for to handle the cases concerning the violation of the rights of the persons with disabilities. So now, though the act is very ambitious, the implementation of this act has some issues. So the study by the Disability Rights India Foundation have found out that there is improper implementation of this act. They have also empirically justified this improper implementation through a statistical data that the number of states and the union territories that have responded to this act is only 66%. That is, only 24 states have taken into consideration of this ambitious act of disability and have made laws over it and properly implemented. Also, this report says about 80% of the states have not allocated state funds for these disabled persons. Also, about 60% of the states do not have the special courts provisions as accorded in the act. So these implementation gaps should be filled in as soon as possible in order to deliver justice for these disabled persons. So now we are going to see the second article, that is the India-US will sort out the sanctions waiver, which was said by the US Secretary, that is James Mattis. So this article has been taken from the paper The Hindu. As we all know, we have a deep history with the Russia in defense cooperation and security equipment purchase. Almost 70% of India's defense equipment has been purchased from Russia. Following this, the recent S-400 Triumph deal was between Russia and India in order to enhance the defense cooperation between these two countries. But India speculated that it would face sanctions from America through its CARTSA, that is, Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act. This act was put on Iran, North Korea, and Russia.
These three countries are tagged as America's adversaries. But US has responded in a way that it has waived the sanctions for India as well as it has done before for China. Following this waiver, India and US are planning to sort out the issues around US sanctions waiver related to this purchase of S-400. So this emphasizes that India is imperative for US in order to counter Chinese mercantilism and assertivism over the Asian region. So to enhance the Indo-US partnership, both countries have recently engaged in the 2+2 dialogue between the foreign secretaries and defense secretaries, wherein which they have come out with many influential and significant agreements. Another important agreement between these two countries is that communications compatibility security agreement, which is abbreviated as COMCASA. In this COMCASA, both the countries have agreed to share the informations regarding the security cooperations. Other areas where discussions underway includes cooperation agreement for geospatial cooperation, which is very much essential to counter the terrorism activities in the Asian region. Also, India's purchases of military equipment from US. So now we are going to see the third article, India's Bhutan Hydel project, which is taken from the article Hindu. India's emphasis on its neighborhood first policy India's emphasis on its neighborhood first policy suggests India to take proactive roles upon its neighbor countries like Nepal and Bhutan. But the India-Bhutan relations are very cordial in nature. It has crossed its 50th anniversary this year. In order to mark this half century of diplomatic ties between India and Bhutan, an Indian Council of World Affairs has been organized. In this conference, India has agreed to set up the hydropower project in Bhutan in the river Mang Dechu. So this is important for prelims point of view, and this deal was backed by Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited, and it will be implemented on a bilateral basis. So cooperation in the hydropower sector shows the sign of strength of the time-tested ties between India and Bhutan. It also to be noted that the India-Bhutan ties had adapted to the changing times. In essence that the recently democratically elected Bhutan government emphasizes its position as a leading democracy in the region. So it is imperative for India to enhance its relations with these landlocked countries like Bhutan and Nepal, which are geographically dependent also, and in order to avoid the Chinese influence over these regions and in order to secure Bhutan's supremacy and sovereignty in the region. So now we are going to see the fourth article, that is the Swadesh Darshan scheme. This article has been taken from the PIB. So this Swadesh Darshan scheme was launched by Ministry of Tourism, wherein which it has sanctioned 25 projects. In this scheme, the Ministry of Tourism is aiding to create theme-based tourist circuits in the country. The scheme was launched in the year 2014 and 15, and so far about 2050 crores have been sanctioned to 21 states and union territories. So there are 13 thematic circuits of this kind especially in the Northeast India, Buddhist region and Himalayan circuit, coastal circuit like this. So the development of these thematic circuits in the country in a planned and prioritized manner is essential to deliver its fullest potential. Apart from this, this scheme has a huge potential for job creation in the country, so in order to engage the youth of this region. So what's the news is that there is a development of a tribal circuit in the state of Nagaland, wherein which Peren Kohima Woka project has been sanctioned and implemented as soon as possible. This will also result in increasing the cleanliness and ecological sustainability over the region. So the next article we are going to see is that India Water Impact Summit of 2018. So this article has been taken from PIB. The Indian government has floated its flagship program of Namami Gange project in 2014 in order to have a clean Ganga. To add a momentum to this project, the government has conducted this India Water Impact Summit especially to focus on the Ganga Basin states, that is the Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, West Bengal, Bihar and Jharkhand. So this India Water Impact Summit is an annual event organized by National Mission for Clean Ganga and Center for Ganga River Basin Management Studies. Here in this summit, the stakeholders will discuss, debate and develop model solutions for the biggest problem of water pollution and the cleanliness problems over the Ganga Basin. Three key aspects of this summit is that the first main is to create a Ganga financing forum in order to bring together the financial institutions as well as the investors interested in this Namami Gange program to fund for this cleanliness program. This program will be a hybrid annuity model, which is a public-private partnership model and it is a combination of engineering, procurement and construction model plus the BOT and the build, operate and transfer PPP model. So it has focused on these five states, as I have said, which is the Ganga Basin states. The government is also very much interested to involve technology and innovative designs in this cleaning process. So the next article we are going to see is the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries. This article has been taken from PIB. As we all know that the recent withdrawal of Qatar from the OPEC membership has poses a question mark on global energy demands as well as India's energy security. So this Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries has been established in the year 1960 with 15 countries that are from Africa, South America and mainly the Gulf countries that are present in West Asia. The 15 main countries include the Saudi Arabia, Iran, United Arab Emirates, Kuwait, Libya, Nigeria, Venezuela, Iraq, Angola, Algeria, Ecuador, Equatorial Guinea, Gabon and Qatar. So this Qatar is leaving from this organization because Qatar focuses to improvise its natural gas production rather than crude production. As Qatar is the fourth largest overall gas reserves in the country and it is the third in production of natural gas. Here it is also to be noted that Venezuela is hosting many oil reserves in the country, but the production is mainly from the West Asian Gulf countries like Saudi Arabia, Qatar and UAE. So the next article is India gets WTO nod to establish dispute panel. So this article has been taken from the paper Indian Express. And here we have to know the structure of WTO. The WTO has a ministerial conference every year where it will be discussing and debating about the trade relations and rules. This ministerial conference has a general council where it has a dispute settlement body. So if there is any trade distortions between two countries or between multilateral countries, it has to approach this dispute settlement body, wherein which a dispute panel would be created and the arbitration would be resolved with its verdict. The another organ of this general council is trade policy review body. This will be regarding the trade policies. And this general council is also further divided into goods council, intellectual property council and services council. So this structure of WTO forms important for the prelims perspective. Here the news is the additional duties upon 25% on steel products and 10% on aluminium has worried Indian exports to the US. Following this, India has approached this dispute settlement body of WTO to resolve this unregulated trade order. Following this, the WTO has agreed to set up a panel to assess if high custom duties imposed by the US on steel and aluminium products infringes on the global trade norms. Here it becomes important because Indian exports of steel and aluminium goods to US worth of $1.6 billion annually. If this trade distortions are going to continue and proper actions are not taken through WTO, it may widen the current account deficit of country as Indian exports are trade surplus with US. So to resolve the trade disputes between the countries, consultation is the first step in the dispute settlement process. If this is not mutually agreed, it will be taken to dispute settlement body where it will pass the verdict over the disputed area. So we are done with the prelims for today. So now we shall see the topics for mains. There are 5 topics, but these 3 topics are pertaining to climate change only. So that is act together and quickly on climate change. Shift to low carbon, cutting through the smog, which is related to the stubble burning and because of which the country's air pollution is increasing. Fourth one is about the more courts to try the criminal netas, which speaks about the judicial pendency of cases. And fifth one is that India's state on global nutrition, especially on stunting and wasting. So the first article is Act Together and Quickly on Climate Change. So this article has been taken from the paper Mint. As we all know that the Conference of Party 24 of UNFCCC is ongoing, it has propelled to take quick actions on climate change. Otherwise, it will have an adverse impact globally. Already, due to some of the anthropogenic activities, the world has warmed by 1 degree Celsius since pre-industrial levels, and it is likely to reach 1.5 degree Celsius between 2030 and 2052. If this is going to continue, it affects the climate vulnerable countries, particularly the developing countries like India and Maldives. If proactive actions are not taken at the right time, it may lead to irreversible damages. A recent review by the ICAR, that is the Indian Council of Agricultural Research, predicts that the crops, plantations and livestock in the 151 districts are going to majorly affected either because of drought or because of flooding. So this poses a question mark on nation's food security. So to counter this climate change, many developed nations have created its nationally determined contributions, wherein which these countries will set a target to have a sustainable development and sustainable utilization of these resources and thereby curb the impacts from climate change. So India's national target is to achieve 40% electric power from non-fossil fuel sources. As we all know that the fossil fuels as the major contributor for global warming, the dependence on fossil fuels for energy demand should be reduced considerably and the non-fossil fuel sources has to be widened. So this should be achieved by 2030 and reduce emission intensity of its GDP by 33-35% from the 2005 levels. So this point becomes very important as it is the target for the India by 2030. As of now, the country has installed 72 gigawatt of renewable energy capacity from the solar, wind and biogas. Upon its reliance on solar power, India also invites other nations through the Solar Alliance framework which was created in the Paris Climate Accord where it emphasizes to prioritize the solar power as the pure source of renewable energy. Based on this, India has created its main theme as One World, One Sun and One Grid in this COP24 Katowice meeting. Though the targets are ambitiously set to counter this climate change, the implementation is in limbo because of the lack of consensus between the like-minded developing countries. So this can be clearly visible from the recent meetings which was held by India between the like-minded developing countries where they spoke about the technology transfer and climate funding from the developed countries are not effective. As the developed world is the main reason for this climate change, it is the developing countries is also mainly affecting. So we are abiding by the principle of polluter shall pay. Where the developed countries are bound to fund the sustainable projects in the developed nations to counter this climate change. Also, in the Cancun summit, which was held in the year 2010, an agenda was brought in to set up a green climate fund with a corpus of $100 billion. So this $100 billion will be funded by the developed countries to initiate the sustainable projects in the developing nations. Though it has been 8 years over, this Green Climate Fund was not properly funded by the developed nations and there is only little money in the corpus. So this COP24, which is going on in Katowice in Poland, is significant to finalize the guidelines for the implementation of the Paris Agreement, which was signed in 2015 and adopted in 2016. Also, some of the researchers have said that the developing countries are going to be the main victim for this climate change rather than the developed countries. So, the poorest countries like the Middle African countries and the tropical Asian countries are going to be the big sufferers, where the poor will be become the poorest because of this climate change. So, because of this, there will be widening of inequality between the developed countries and developing nations. So, in order to bridge this protection gap between the rich and the poor, there should be a strike balance between adaptation and mitigation projects. So the way forward for this is the COP24 should be able to frame guidelines which are pragmatic and give due consideration to the challenges and priorities of the developing countries. So these pragmatic solutions would help the developing nations to further get developed. So the next 15 years are considered to be critical for action on climate change, and any delay would only render it impossible to meet the ambitious goal in the Paris Agreement, where it has set a target to meet the 1.5 degrees Celsius within 2100. So following this climate change conference, it is imperative for India to shift its economy towards the low carbon economy. So this article is written in Hindi. In this article, a report study says that the decadal mean maximum temperature has crossed over 40 to 42 degrees Celsius over large parts of India. So this will have a major ramifications to the agriculture and other allied activities. So because of the increase in the maximum temperature, it will heat the air and thereby it makes the moisture holding capacity to increase, which results in more intense rainfall in certain parts of the country where it makes prone to the flooding. And not only this, it also provides more energy for storms and thereby it would be lead to create many cyclones over the coastal regions. This maximum temperature also lead to warming of the coastal waters, rendering it unsuitable for certain species of fish, thereby affects the livelihood of the coastal population. So because of this climate change, there are two extreme conditions in India, like longer summers and hotter summers in one region and excessive rainfall over the other region. So it is to be noted that heat waves are the culprit which leads to the droughts and rainfall over the regions in the country. So it should be tagged as a silent disaster and proactive steps to be taken to curb this heat waves. So one such significant step to curb this climate change is to shift to the low carbon economy. In the absence of such shift, would rise the temperature more than 2 degrees Celsius by the end of this century. So here we have to see the role of the developing and developed countries to mitigate the climate change. A best role model is the Japan, which has invested a lot of money on the coastal defenses and thereby it created a world's largest underground flood water diversion facility. So India should take cue from Japan in developing such infrastructural projects. As I said earlier, that adaptation only will not suffice unless mitigation takes the central stage among the world's leading emitters like India and other Asian nations. But contradicting to the goals set by the Indian government to curb the climate change, it has planned to build two new coal-fired power plants, which should be abandoned and replaced with a renewable source of energy like wind and solar power. So, apart from taking steps to adapt to climate change, India should voice in decarbonizing the world economy to curb the climate change and its impacts globally. So the next article is cutting through the smog, which is also dealing with the air pollution in the northern region of India, which also speaks about the impact of the global warming because of the unsustainable methods of agriculture. So already the government has taken some steps to curb this stubble burning, which is not efficient as proclaimed by the author in this article. Stubble burning cannot be averted by imposing fines or giving notice or giving farmers capital subsidy. Rather, it needs a longer term vision and policy interventions to control the air pollution and other continuing impacts. But for the country's air pollution, farmers are held responsible by the central and the state governments. But the reality is that there are flawed and short-sighted policies which does not focus on other issues which contributes to this air pollution. Because this stubble burning is contributing less than 20% for this air pollution. Besides air pollution, other negative externalities related to this stubble burning are land degradation, adverse soil health due to the overuse of fertilizers and pesticides, and plummeting water tables, which are causing the agriculture to become unsustainable. Though crop rotation can be acclaimed as a sustainable method of agriculture, the increase of only wheat and paddy crop rotation has undisputedly been at the cost of maize, cotton, oilseed and sugarcane cultivation. So this practice of unsustainable methods of agriculture is rendered by the policy of minimum support price for the crops, which only focuses on certain kharif and rabi crops, leaving out the other crops. At the same time, the assured procurement and input subsidy by the government has stressed the farmers to cultivate only wheat and paddy over the regions, and thereby destroying the soil fertility and improper water usage. Besides this, Punjab has enacted a water conservation law in 2009 which mandates paddy sowing within a notified period. So, prior to this law, the cultivators have been sowing the paddy in the month of May. But this law has postponed this sowing period to June, and also at the same time it is a shorter period wherein which the farmers are compelled to cultivate the paddy within this short period through some unsustainable methods. The government's initiative to abate the stubble burning, it forces the farmers to purchase the happy seeder. Because of this, they are put under an economical distress. And that leads to a debt trap, which at last costing the lives of the farmers through suicide. So the way forward is that the government should encourage crop diversification towards less water intensive crops. Also, a policy of price deficiency system should be adopted in order to strengthen the production and marketing of the alternative crops, which increases the other non-covered MSP crops. It is also good to replicate the Telangana model of providing the farmers an investment support of Rs 8000 per acre each year and withdraw the price-based support through MSP. So this scheme is called the Ritu Bandhu scheme. Also, it would be good if the state provides an app-based support system to rent out tractors and farm implements rather than to force the farmers to purchase the happy seeder harvester. So this can be technically referred as Uberization of agriculture and thereby earn an additional income. And apart from sensitizing the farmers to refrain from the burning residue, they are also to be made aware of the options available for the biomass generation, wherein which the agricultural residues can be generated into energy. So for this, the farmers can be incentivized to sell the residual for an additional income.
So the final article for today's analysis is Stunted and Wasted on the Global Nutrition Report 2018. So this article has been taken from Hindu. So recently, the Global Nutrition Report for 2018 has been released. This report speaks about that the grave nutrition situation that the world today faces. Especially the nutritional status of India is that the health, the longevity, as well as the well-being of Indians has been improved since independence. But a third of world's stunted children under 5, which means the low height for age, lives in India. Also, a quarter of the children in India display the wasting, which means the low weight for height. Apart from this, this report focuses on wide regional variation in India, that the central and the north Indian states are suffering from 30-40% of the malnutrition children. But the entire south is only suffering from 20% of the nutritional deficiency. This disparity can be attributed to the political commitment, administrative efficiency, literacy, and women's empowerment in ensuring the children's health, especially in the southern region, and in the north it is lacking. So here it is to be noted that the determinants of malnutrition are hunger, ignorance of healthy diets, unsafe and unclean water, inadequate investment in health and other sectors, changing lifestyles, inadequate health infrastructure, technology and services accessibility, and weak implementation of the government's nutrition schemes, unemployment, poverty and other social issues are attributing for this malnutrition. So in order to address this malnutrition, the government has taken some steps like National Nutrition Mission, where it has created a national framework to improve the nutrition which already exists. In this National Nutrition Mission, the government has emphasized to enhance the efficiency of Anganwadi services schemes, which incorporates the integrated child development services that caters to the children up to the age of 6 and to the pregnant and lactating women. So project implementation becomes imperative here. However, the implementation of the integrated child development scheme has some flaws in it. Going by the report, only 21% of these nutrition-rich packaged foods are rated as healthy. So the way forward is, India should invest more in its economic prosperity, in its welfare system, without binding itself in restrictive budgetary formulations, and thereby to achieve the directive principles of state policy, where it says about the well-being and health of the citizens should be improvised, and thereby to harness the potential of the demographic dividends. The economic survey in 2017-18 put social services spending at 6.6% of GDP, which is an insignificant rise, which is a marginal decline from the 6% band during the previous year to 5.8%. So the state and center should work in tandem to provide the India's children a healthy future. So it becomes a major commitment for our government. Thank you.